Morning, everybody. We are 5 days before Election Day, and this might be another November surprise. A bombshell report involving the FBI and the Clinton Foundation and whether or not donors received special access while Hillary Clinton was Secretary of State. How will this now play out in a razor-tight race? Talk about a game seven. We've got one now, huh? Right. I'm Bill Hemmer. Good morning. Welcome.
Good morning to you. Good morning, everybody. I'm Martha McCallum. So really, I mean, time is running out here for Donald Trump and for Hillary Clinton. Both of their teams will fan out in the critical battleground states today. Donald Trump in Florida and in North Carolina, both extremely important in this race. Governor Mike Pence goes to Pennsylvania. Melania Trump will also be in Pennsylvania. We'll talk about that in a little bit. Iowa and Michigan also on the docket for the vice presidential candidate on the Republican side. Hillary Clinton will also be in North Carolina. It's going to get a little crowded in North Carolina today. Senator Tim Kaine will be in Arizona as they try to make some headway there.
See on the tarmac. Fox team coverage now. John Roberts with the Trump team in Florida. I want to start, though, with Chief Intelligence Correspondent Catherine Herridge with the latest on this Clinton investigation. And good morning, Catherine. What have we found out as of last night and this morning?
Well, thank you, Bill. There is new evidence that the FBI's investigation of the Clinton Foundation is not dead. FBI agents, we understand, are quietly working the Clinton Foundation case out of four offices, including Southern California, Arkansas, Washington, D.C., and New York City. Multiple sources have told Fox News that the Justice Department has been tapping the brakes on these investigations by blocking access to a grand jury. As part of its ongoing investigation, Fox News was first to report in January that the FBI email probe had expanded to look at whether the intersection of Clinton Foundation work at the State Department and business under Secretary Clinton may have violated public corruption laws. While State Department emails and WikiLeaks now show evidence of coordination, in January, Hillary Clinton tried to dismiss the reporting as rumor. Meantime, we have new information about computers belonging to Clinton's personal attorney, Cheryl Mills, and aide Heather Samuelson. These computers were not destroyed as part of an immunity agreement with the Justice Department. Instead, what we understand now is that these computers are being held by the FBI's Washington field office, and they are still available to investigators in the foundation case.
Okay, so the president was talking about this. What did he say about the FBI director's decision 6 days, would have been yesterday before the election?
Well, Bill, you know as well as I do that it's just not protocol to discuss ongoing investigations. But in this new interview, the president seemed to dismiss FBI Director James Comey's decision to reinitiate the Hillary Clinton email case.
People say crazy stuff about her, and when she makes a mistake, an honest mistake, it ends up being blown up as if it's just some crazy thing.
But there's important context here. The president has a stake in the outcome. As the State Department revealed earlier this year, he was corresponding with Hillary Clinton using her personal email address.
I can confirm that as part of this monthly FOIA production of former Secretary Clinton's emails, the State Department will be denying in full seven email chains found in 22 documents representing 37 pages. The documents are being upgraded at the request of the intelligence community because they contain a category of top secret information. These documents were not marked classified at the time that they were sent.
Look, one of the key things we learned in the FBI interviews known as 302s came from Clinton aide Huma Abedin. She told the FBI investigators that every time Hillary Clinton's personal address changed, they would update the White House so that the president could continue receiving Hillary Clinton's emails on his high security devices, including his BlackBerry. And the reason that matters is that that is evidence that goes to knowledge of the White House, of this personal system and the changing addresses. So this is something where the president and the White House clearly have a horse in the race and a stake in the outcome.
Well, Catherine, great reporting there on behalf of you and Brett Baer. Thank you. We'll be back with
you
throughout the morning here. In a moment, you'll hear from the man who wrote the book, Clinton Cash. Peter Schweizer was interviewed repeatedly by federal agents about claims that he made in his book. his take on the FBI's investigation just minutes away at 9:15 Eastern Time with Peter live.
So much to dig into here today, and we will take you through it step by step. Meanwhile, Donald Trump fanning out against across the battleground states today as we enter the home stretch. He will be in Florida. He will be in North Carolina, both very, very important to the outcome of this race. There's a new poll out this morning from the New York Times and CBS News that shows this is very tight indeed, 45 to 42, right in the margin of error, which is plus or minus 3% on that one. Senior national correspondent John Roberts joins us now live from Jacksonville, Florida, where he is covering the Trump campaign. John, good morning to you.
Martha, good morning to you. A lot of Donald Trump supporters have been lining up here, getting ready for his rally at noon today at the Jacksonville Equestrian Center. The line extends about 300 yards behind me this way and about 600 yards that way. So he's going to pack the place out today. New Quinnipiac poll shows that a very close race in the Sunshine State here with his 29 electoral votes, 46% for Hillary Clinton, 45% for Donald Trump. His strategy over the next 5 days, really three big things. Keep the focus on policy, illuminate and articulate what he would do differently than Hillary Clinton. Keep the spotlight on her and the various controversies that are swirling around her campaign. And third, and perhaps most importantly for Donald Trump, stay the heck out of trouble. Here he is in Pensacola last night.
We've got to be nice and cool, nice and cool. Right? Stay on point, Donald, stay on point. No sidetracks, Donald. Nice and easy, nice. Because I've been watching Hillary the last few days. She's totally unhinged. We don't want any of that.
One source told me yesterday that after all of these months and after getting himself in so much trouble over all of that time, he finally understands that he's got to stay on point. Message discipline is key now in these closing days of the campaign. He's gotten it close, and people believe that one outburst could derail the whole thing. So they're trying to keep him very tightly focused here, Martha.
Yeah, fascinating. So in terms of the latest reporting, Brett Baer last night talking about a potential indictment even coming down in the investigation into the Clinton Foundation. What will the Trump campaign do with that, John?
I mean, it's like pennies from heaven for the Trump campaign. Almost every day, Martha, some new revelation pops up that gives him plenty of ammunition to use against Hillary Clinton. He'll be talking a lot about that today. He'll be talking a lot about the emails between the between Department of Justice officials and the Clinton campaign, basically saying on the campaign trail that if she is elected president, what we're hearing now could be just the beginning. Listen.
Just the beginning. Hillary is likely to be under investigation for many years, probably concluding in criminal trials. It's just been shown that this is, as I've been saying, a rigged system with more collusion, possibly illegal, between the Justice Department, the Clinton campaign, and the State Department.
And this afternoon, Donald Trump's wife Melania will be on the campaign trail. She has got a big speech this afternoon in Berwyn, Pennsylvania, trying to bring more Republican women into the polls in the next 5 days and on Election Day. Something really interesting, too, in the Philadelphia area to keep watching, Martha, is they're about to go into the third day of a transit strike. SEPTA is still on strike there. If they are still on strike as of Tuesday, that could depress voter turnout. And if you get bad weather and you get a transit strike, that could bode very well for Republicans on Tuesday around the Philadelphia area.
All right. We'll be watching that. Melania in the suburban areas where the women's vote is so important in this race. John Roberts, thank you very much in Florida right now. Bill, over to you.
Martha, clearly the focus on these battleground states. Tom Bevin, executive editor, Real Clear Politics, where they take all the average of all the polls and they try and figure this out. Tom, good morning to you. I want to show our viewers where you have the race right now, okay? And jump in here when it's appropriate and stop me if... Well, if you think we're on the right path or the wrong path based on how you see it, right? At the moment, you see Georgia and Arizona where Trump has a lead. You also have, in your Real Clear average now, a lead for Trump in Florida, in Ohio, in Iowa, and Nevada. So that would put him at a 270, a 250 electoral votes. You also have North Carolina in a dead heat, correct? So if he were to win North Carolina, he's only at 265. And on the map, based on your scenario, Colorado's out there, Wisconsin, Michigan, Pennsylvania, Virginia, and New Hampshire. Among those remaining states, what's the story, Tom?
Well, Colorado, the polls have tightened dramatically. I mean, Clinton's lead there is down to 2 points, so that's looking perhaps promising for the Trump campaign. We had a poll out this morning, Bill, showing Trump with a one-point lead in New Hampshire. And, of course, if Trump wins New Hampshire, that would lead to a 269-269 tie, which would make heads explode all over the country, I'm sure. And then there's also that congressional district in Maine where Trump has been running pretty strong. So the other states, though, Pennsylvania has tightened, Virginia has tightened, mm-hmm. Wisconsin and Michigan are a little bit sort of the next tier out, although we did have a poll that showed Clinton's lead dropped about 3 points in Michigan, but other polls have shown that race about six, 7 points.
Let me show you what came out of Colorado yesterday. It has not done a lot of polling out there. This is the University of Denver. It has Clinton and Trump at 39-39 apiece. And the Trump team was in studio a week ago, and they said, look out of Colorado. We thought at the moment it was spin. Maybe it is and maybe it is not. But under this scenario, if he were to take Colorado, he's a 274. He's at the number, Tom.
No, exactly. I mean, Colorado is one of those states. It's been really swingy. I mean, you know, Clinton had a big lead there, then it disappeared in September, and then she busted back out to a pretty substantial lead in October. But it has tightened up rather quickly, rather dramatically. And again, it represents an opportunity. Those are only nine electoral votes in Colorado, but could be huge. In the final analysis, if Trump was able to swing that state his way.
No question. Tom, thank you. Real Clear Politics there, Tom Bevin. Thank you, sir.
You bet.
Talk soon. Martha?
So 5 days to go, and you come along for the ride with us, and we've got you covered on this. We will get you all of the results as they come in, the facts, the analysis.
Top story right now, the ongoing investigation on the Clinton Foundation. Peter Schweizer wrote the book Clinton Cash. He's also the executive producer of the documentary by the same name, and he is my guest in Tallahassee, Florida. And Peter, good morning to you. You have found yourself in the middle of all of this. Thank you for your time right now. I want to go through a number of things over the next 4 minutes. Number one,
sure.
Wall Street Journal reports secret recordings of a suspect who was involved in your research. Who was that suspect, Peter?
I don't actually know who that suspect was. What I'll tell you, Bill, is that, you know, look, there are four trustee members of the Clinton Foundation that have been subject to either prosecution or have been convicted of financial crime. So there are multiple possibilities, but I don't know who that individual is.
Okay, why would they come up in your research as it pertains to what involving the Clintons?
Well, what really happened is the book came out last year. The FBI, it was described to me, saw this as a roadmap to how this corruption was taking place. But, you know, like any roadmap, it doesn't have a lot of detail. You know, you follow down a road, but you don't know what the road looks like. You don't know what stores are on the side of the road. And that's what they've gone about to do. So as much as I'd like to say the book is the entire case, that is not the case. That's certainly how the Clinton team is going to represent it. But they have done a lot of legwork, as you would expect the FBI to do. And this okay. is a high priority for
so
them.
You were interviewed multiple times with the FBI, correct? Correct?
That's correct.
Put a number on that. How many?
I don't want to say that. What I can tell you is my last contact was the end of February. So, again, the contention that this is somehow the FBI going rogue based on a book, they are doing a lot of other stuff. The book, I think, was just the roadmap, but
okay,
I'd rather
so
not go into detail.
For how long?
That.
When did this investigation start within the FBI?
It started literally a week or two after the book was released.
Okay, so that was May of 2015, correct?
So that's correct.
That was last summer. Now, some of these agents believe that interview was hearsay. Could it have been?
Yeah. Well, I think the prosecutors believe that it was. I don't think the agents do. What you have here is divide between the field agents, particularly the white-collar criminal division of the FBI, and career prosecutors at the Department of Justice. So they're having this dispute about the evidence. I'm not a lawyer. I don't know how to interpret that. But there is more. It's not just this recording and this book. The agents haven't been reading the book for 16 months and have one recording. There's a lot more information. So this is not going to go away. It's not going to begin and end with this book and this with recording. There's going to be more, I think,
okay.
that's going
to
come out.
To our viewers who have not read your book and are not familiar with the work, did you prove pay for play?
I think we showed a pattern of behavior, just like with insider trading on the stock market, that you either have to look and see that this pattern of money and favors being done is this statistically impossible set of coincidences, or the events are connected. What agents need to do, and of course what prosecutors need to do, is fill in those gaps, fill in the detail on this roadmap, as it were, and that's what they've gone about doing over these last 16 months or so.
Clinton Foundation denies any wrongdoing. Do you think a pattern or not, Peter?
I think I established a pattern that required investigation, which is what the FBI is doing. The problem is, frankly, they are being denied tools by the Department of Justice. They've interviewed lots of people. So for the Clinton Foundation to say they don't know of any investigation is just flat out wrong. There have been a lot of interviews conducted. What Department of Justice prosecutors are not giving them is subpoena power, which I think is crucial in this, in proving this kind of case.
Okay, now you would concede the disagreements are typical, right? People look at evidence in different ways. But what you are saying is that the Justice Department tried or has tried to stop this investigation on behalf of the FBI.
Yeah, there's been wide reporting on this. Brett Baer did that yesterday, the Wall Street Journal yesterday, others. It's very, very clear. And here's the problem. This is a Department of Justice that has been politicized. I don't think anybody can dispute that. And so this is crying out for an independent investigator. When you've got the Department of Justice, the Attorney General, meeting with Bill Clinton, who at the time is the subject, through his foundation, of a federal investigation, and then you have, of course, now these leaks from this other Department of Justice official to John Podesta, I mean, it reeks of the fact that there's political favoritism at the Department of Justice, and you just can't have confidence in the investigation. That's why it's incumbent upon them not just to avoid conflicts of interest, but to avoid the appearance of conflicts of interest, and they have certainly not done that.
Clearly, people are talking. Peter Schweizer, thank you for your time. I'm out of time now.
Thanks,
live
Bill.
In Florida. Thank you.
So here's the question for both sides. Can Donald Trump flip a blue state red, or Hillary Clinton do the reverse? Who gets to 270? We'll explore the possible routes when we come back.
We've raised over $100 million in small donations. I don't think that's ever been done. Has that ever been done before? That sounds more like a Democrat thing, not a Republican thing, right? That's a great honor. That means there are a lot of people out there that want us to really get this done.
Oh, boy. I mean, could this be any more interesting at this point? Donald Trump spending the remaining days of the campaign in the battleground states, which you would expect. Both candidates are doing that. Hillary Clinton still appears to be leading in several of the crucial states. She's ahead in most of the polls that we got yesterday, but by fairly slim margins, within the margin of error in some cases. The race is very tight, folks, especially in some of the areas that are potentially flip states. So can Donald Trump turn some of those blue states red? Hillary Clinton is out there trying to do exactly the opposite. Let's talk about this with Sean Spicer, Chief Strategist and Communications Director for the RNC. Sean, how's it going?
It's going great. What a 5 days we've got before this thing's over. The momentum is with us. The map keeps shifting day in and day out. The polls, both nationally and in the key battleground states, show a continued growth for Donald Trump.
But do you have enough time? I mean, five days.
We do. I mean, but if you look at that ABC News poll that came out the other day, a 12-point swing in eight days. You saw the North Carolina poll yesterday. A Virginia poll came out yesterday showing an 8-point swing for Donald Trump. He's now up one in the Hampton University poll. It's the revelations that have happened in the last week, and it's not just the FBI scandals, which is now plural. It is the Obamacare double-digit hikes. It's the Clinton Inc., the pay-per-play, everything of this. It's a perfect storm coming against Hillary Clinton, and I think the momentum and the message of change that Donald Trump and Mike Pence are bringing is what is bringing people home, is what taking independents off the fence, and it's going to put him to victory on November 8th.
We will see. Let's take a look at Wisconsin, which is one of those states that I know you folks are counting on and hoping is going to go Republican. Right now, it's about 5 points apart, according to the latest poll. That's a pretty decent spread in Wisconsin. How do you see that changing?
Well, so if you look at the current map, we believe we're ahead in Florida, Ohio, Iowa, North Carolina. You take that aside,
she's ahead too in all the polls.
Everything that we're seeing in the data, both in terms of the early vote and the absentee vote, you're seeing, look, there was a New York Times tweet today that showed, where if you go to Jeremy Peters' Twitter feed from the New York Times. He says the Clinton campaign is cherry-picking the data. And it's true. If you look at it
and
overall...
And he just, for our viewers at home, he's the guy who's been really watching the early vote tallies, Jeremy Peters,
and so you realize that what they're selling people... Democrats have to win the early vote. They've always done it. They run up the score. In North Carolina alone, Barack Obama led the early vote by 300,000 going into Election Day, and Mitt Romney carried it. They're not even close to that 300,000 right now. Our early vote returns are up. Theirs are down. And when we see that, that allows us to really look at North Carolina and think that we're going to carry that. And when we go from there, you talk about Wisconsin. We've got Wisconsin, Michigan, Colorado, New Mexico, Virginia, Pennsylvania.
Right,
we just got to pick out one.
You're talking about your numbers, right? And the numbers that everybody else is seeing on the screen, and let's put Michigan up, still show her ahead in all of them. Now, your numbers may be right.
No, no.
Or their numbers may be right, but they're in contradiction. So, you know, does it make you nervous when you look up from your numbers and see those numbers?
Well, there's no question that we've seen a tightening in those things. But again, in six states, Wisconsin, Michigan, Pennsylvania, Virginia, New Mexico, Colorado, we just have to get one, just one. So the way we're going, I think I like our odds, right?
Okay.
And that's about a, you know, 1 in 18 shot that we have to pick off one of those states. But each of them, in every one of them, they're closing. And you look at it, and Hillary Clinton and Priorities USA, their big super PAC, went back up on the air in Colorado, Michigan, and Wisconsin because they're worried. They see what we see, and that's a tightening of this race for Donald Trump and Mike Pence.
I mean, when you think about the fact that a week ago, Hillary Clinton was, you know, talking like a winner. She put a picture of herself on Twitter when she was a child that said, you know, the next president of the United States or something to that effect. And they are clearly in defense mode at this point in the Clinton camp. You know, in terms of the stories and what you see, though, in different places, I was amazed this morning. I was listening to CNN very early, and, you know, they were talking about Matt Schlapp was on, who, you know, our viewers see here often as well. And he said, you know, well, now that there are two FBI investigations going on, and I believe it was Chris Cuomo said, you know, two? What are you talking about? I mean, all those viewers, you know, don't have any idea that there are actually two foundation and emails that are serious FBI investigations going on.
And I think for a lot of the media, they don't want to discuss what's going on in Hillary Clinton. You look at the last couple of days, they want to talk about Jim Comey and his standing and did he have the president. The bottom line is the only reason that we have any FBI investigations is because of the Clintons' personal actions, their paper play, their decision to have one set of rules and cover up the secret server, their continued lying about them turning over all the documents. This investigation, or these investigations, weren't made up out of whole cloth. They were made up because the Clintons continued a 30-year pattern of lying to the American people and having one set of rules.
One more question. I know I'm out of time, but you know, Donald Trump himself said, "I gotta stay calm. I can't make any mistakes.
Right.
I gotta stay on message." How worried are you that he won't?
He gets it. He understands what's at stake. You hear him over and over again. He knows that he is a messenger of change and that he has a movement behind him. And he understands that in 5 days, he is going to get elected the next president of the United States, and Mike Pence will be the next vice president.
We will see. Sean Spicer, always good to see you.
Good to see
Thank you.
You
very much.
So guess where Clinton and Trump are both?
We don't win this election, potentially, if we don't win North Carolina. So I hate to put a little pressure on you, but the fate of the republic rests on your shoulders.
So there's the president. The fate of the entire 2016 presidential race could come down to the state of North Carolina. There's a lot of ways to look at this, but this is one scenario that we need to take a close look at. The Tar Heel State went for President Obama in 08, but flipped Republican 4 years ago for Mitt Romney. The latest Quinnipiac poll shows Hillary Clinton has a 3-point edge in North Carolina, which is within the margin of error. And as you just heard from the RNC, they're quite encouraged about that. They're feeling very good about North Carolina. So let's check in with the governor there, Pat McCrory, and see how he's feeling about it. Governor, welcome. Good to have you with us this morning.
It's good to be back. Thanks for having me, Martha.
So North Carolina is fascinating to look at in this race. You are in a fairly tight race for governor. You've got Senator Burr and Ross also in a very tight race for the Senate seat. So this is sort of squeaky all around. Why do you think the Democrats are spending so much time? The president's coming back there twice on Friday. Why are they there so much?
I think two factors have entered North Carolina. One is incredible Clinton fatigue with the emails, with the Clinton Foundation, and it's like we're living back in the 90s again. And I think people are finally realizing in North Carolina, we don't need the 90s return back to North Carolina and have all this Clinton fatigue. And the other thing that is happening is the Obamacare premiums are hitting very hard. And my opponent, Roy Cooper, was a very strong proponent of Obamacare, refused to join in a lawsuit against it. And now Obamacare is just disastrous for North Carolina with premiums going up over 30%. So Clinton fatigue, Obamacare, I think both the president and Hillary and Joe, they're all coming here as much as possible to try to get the Democrats enthusiastic, but we don't see it happening on the ground.
So we've been talking about the early vote count, and one of the things that has been noticed clearly is that the early vote among black voters in North Carolina is down. At this point, the last time around, it was at 27%. Now it's at 22%. And some are criticizing your state, saying that the closing of some of those early voting areas is what is causing that. What do you say?
Absolutely not true. In fact, we extended the hours for some of the voting.
But there are fewer places to go, correct?
Fewer places to go, but extended hours. So second and third shift workers can actually vote. And that's very, very good news for North Carolina. But the extended hours, even as we've extended the number of locations during the past week throughout North Carolina, we've seen no real pattern change regarding North Carolina voters. And I think it is really due to Clinton fatigue. And, you know, when President Obama was on the ballot, there was a passion there with a lot of voters. But now that he's not on the ballot, no matter how much he tries to tie it to his legacy, they know it's all about Hillary Clinton and Roy Cooper and others that will just bring in the old good old boy system back to inefficient politics, high taxes, and Obamacare, which is just really causing some serious problems here in many other states.
You know, in terms of voters who are turning out or will turn out on November 8th, who have not voted in a long time, what is your feel for that in the rural areas in North Carolina?
We see the lower populated areas very enthusiastic about voting. I was in Henderson, North Carolina yesterday at a small mom and pop restaurant. And just, I was overwhelmed by the people coming to my breakfast table saying, we're voting for the first time, we're bringing the entire family, we're bringing our entire neighborhood. So I do see a lot of people in the less populated areas really enthusiastic about the vote from the top of the ticket all the way to the governor's race and to Senator Burr's race.
So Senator Burr is the chairman of the Intel Committee. Obviously, you know, he would have spent quite a bit of time looking into some of the issues that are really coming into the forefront in the final weeks here in terms of the Clinton Foundation and the FBI investigation into the emails as well. Tell me what your take is on that race for now.
Well, I think Richard's going to win. He's very well respected. He's very low key. No ego whatsoever. None of the trappings of a senator. I'm a big fan of Richard Burr, and he's a very good friend, and he's a solid, solid, smart person. Plus, he's an expert on health care also. And another issue here in North Carolina is we've had this tremendous hurricane here, which devastated our state, and we lost 28 people due to this hurricane, and we're still dealing with this hurricane, and hopefully people are pleased with the way our team has responded to this hurricane. And so that's also another big issue here in addition to Obamacare. People are hurting right now in a lot of our small, lower populated towns that were devastated by the hurricane.
We can appreciate that, and our hearts go out to them, to be sure. It's going to be very crowded in your state over the next few days. President Obama is going to be in two different places there, and you've got both campaigns touching down today. So we wish you all good luck in dealing with all that. Governor, thanks for the time today.
Thank you very much.
You wonder, based on what we're seeing, if North Carolina is the new Florida?
Could be.
Or Ohio?
It could be.
I mean, they talk about politics being on steroids right now in North Carolina, given all the issues in that state.
You have a scenario where the places that we're used to looking at as swing states may expand or may contract, but it may not be like anything we've seen in the past. So that's what makes our job
15
fun,
electoral.
Right?
That's right. 15 electoral votes there. Donald Trump making a new push for women today. His wife, Melania, will make her first solo campaign appearance in Pennsylvania. So what case will she make for her husband? We'll check in on that.
It's going to be interesting. We're going to talk about that coming up. Plus, days of negative headlines taking a toll on Hillary Clinton as a new poll finds that more voters find Donald Trump to be trustworthy than Hillary Clinton. One of her rivals, Martin O'Malley, will talk to us about that, what he thinks, when we come back. But first, here is Donald Trump.
The polls are all saying we're going to win Florida. Don't believe it. Don't believe it. Get out there and vote. Pretend we're slightly behind. You got to get out. We don't want to...
You know, a week can be a lifetime in politics. We find a brand new poll that finds voters trust Donald Trump more than Hillary Clinton. He leads now in that polling 46-38%. Former Maryland Governor Martin O'Malley, a one-time candidate, Hillary Clinton supporter with me now. And, sir, thanks for coming back.
Thank you, Bill.
To America's Newsroom. 8 points. What's going on there? Honesty and trustworthy.
Yeah, well, look, I think we have known for a while that the two nominees – and of both parties are two of the candidates that the American people might say they dislike least. But the truth is, at the end of the day, people are going to have to decide which of these two individuals can actually do the job of President of the United States, and which one of them is most likely to take the actions that will make wages go up again for all families. Hillary Clinton will take those actions. Donald Trump has said wages are too high in America. And at the end of the day, people will trust that Secretary Clinton is going to be on the side of growing America's middle class.
Just to continue the question about character, honesty, and trustworthiness. What effect does this FBI investigation have on her campaign this week?
Oh, I think it was a huge cheap shot. I mean, no
cheap
doubt.
Shot.
Yeah, I do believe it's a cheap shot. I mean, this email investigation was probably the longest email investigation in FBI history. And for them to go back and gratuitously say they're looking at potentially new evidence, which they even admit may or may not be related to Secretary Clinton, I think is a cheap shot. I mean, the FBI is also looking at Russian...
What if we find out that in the end the FBI's onto something?
Yeah, and what if we find out that Donald Trump has actually been talking, and his campaign has been talking with the Russians? Paul Manafort, his campaign manager, is being investigated, former campaign manager, is being investigated for his Russian ties and the millions that he received from Russian sources. What if we find out about that? What if we find out
but
that...
But it just shows the position, potentially, the FBI director was in. Now, you called it a cheap shot, and just yesterday,
right,
President Obama did an interview. I think he was in Florida when he questioned the FBI's decision. This is what he said about that.
There is a norm that, you know, when there are investigations, we don't operate on innuendo, we don't operate on incomplete information, we don't operate on leaks. We operate based on concrete decisions that are made.
It is rare when a president criticizes the head of the FBI. Was that a cheap shot?
No, I believe that the cheap shot was what Mr. Comey did within this decision window when people were voting, a decision he made contrary to all of the advice of lawyers at the Department of Justice and contrary to his own instinct when he said that he didn't want to, along with the other 15 security agencies, say that the Russians were responsible definitively for the DNC hack because he was afraid that might be misinterpreted in the election. Well, if he was afraid that might be misinterpreted, then why would he send a letter like this to Republicans saying that that information that he admits he has no idea is or is not connected to Secretary Clinton?
Was the president wrong to criticize the head of the FBI?
No, I think he was right, and I think he's not alone. This is unprecedented. There's something strange going on at the FBI. I don't know what it is. I think eventually we'll find out. But before that time, we're all going to vote on Tuesday nonetheless. And come hell or high water, whatever the Russians want, whatever cheap shots people want to fire at Hillary Clinton in these final days, people are going to go to the polls and confirm that only Hillary Clinton can actually do this job. Unlike Donald Trump, she doesn't confuse our enemies for our allies, and she wants wages to go up, and Donald Trump believes wages are too high in America.
I know you think she'll win. What's the margin on Tuesday?
Oh, I've given up my entire ability to predict. I think Secretary Clinton is going to win. I believe that she's going to win many states that people today might predict that she will not win. I myself am going to be in North Carolina, where Pat McCrory, who you just had on, trailing the Democratic challenger, Roy Cooper.
They've got some good battles in North Carolina, so get a measure on the ground there. Martin O'Malley is now on the record. Thank you for your time today.
Thank
sir.
You.
You bet.
The Clinton Foundation. This is brand new information. The FBI now treating the investigation as a very high priority, and this has been propelled by an avalanche of brand new evidence that's been uncovered by FBI investigators, according to multiple sources. Welcome, everybody. Brand new hour of America's Newsroom starts now. I'm Martha McCallum.
And I'm Bill Hemmer. Good morning. The FBI's white-collar crime division aggressively pursuing this case. Brand new details emerging by the day. And part of this investigation started after a book called Clinton Cash was released about 18 months ago. And the author of that book, Peter Schweizer, telling us last hour how his story has been used by investigators.
The FBI, it was described to me, saw this as a roadmap to how this corruption was taking place. But, you know, like any roadmap, it doesn't have a lot of detail. You know, you follow down a road, but you don't know what the road looks like. You don't know what stores are on the side of the road. And that's what they've gone about to do.
Brett Baer, anchor of Special Report, joins us. Broke a lot of news on this last evening. Brett, good morning to you. Good to have you with us this morning. I want to actually start by going back to Jim Comey's testimony in front of Congress. After he made the press, did the press conference on July 5th of this summer, this past summer, he then said he wanted to further explain and go before Congress. Jason Chaffetz, the congressman, asked him a very pointed question, and I'd like to play that for everybody now.
Did you look at the Clinton Foundation?
I'm not going to comment on the existence or non-existence of any other investigations.
Was the Clinton Foundation tied into this investigation?
Yeah, I'm not going to answer that.
We all remember that moment, Brett, and now we know that that investigation was very much underway.
Yeah, Martha, it never stopped, according to two sources intimately familiar with the inner workings of this investigation, not only the classified email investigation headed up by the National Security Division, but the Clinton Foundation investigation headed up by the White-Collar Crimes Division of Public Corruption. A couple of things. One is there is an internal battle inside, not only between the FBI and the DOJ over this investigation, but even inside the FBI. It was detailed in a Wall Street Journal piece today. We can confirm a lot of that. But I will tell you that for inside the investigation itself, there is a high confidence that they have a lot of evidence. The evidence continues, according to our sources, to come in every day, not just by WikiLeaks, but also by the other avenues that they are doing, multiple interviews several times, and also these new emails, Martha. You have the Anthony Weiner computer, and then we've confirmed, and Catherine Herridge has another source on this, that the Cheryl Mills and Heather Samuelson computers that were part of an immunity deal that originally were thought to have been destroyed by the FBI as part of that deal were never destroyed, and that they are now at the Washington field office of the FBI. So they have a lot of avenues to look for different elements of evidence.
Okay. The FBI sources that you spoke with suggest that an indictment is likely that would
now prove. I want to be clear. I want to be clear about this. And this was came from a Q&A that I did with Britt Hume after my show and after we went through everything. He asked me after the election, if Hillary Clinton wins, will this investigation continue? And I said, yes, absolutely. I pressed these sources again and again. What would happen? I got to the end of that and said, you know, they have a lot of evidence that would likely lead to an indictment. But that's inartfully answered. That's not the process. That's not how you do it. You have to have a prosecutor. If they don't move forward with a prosecutor with the DOJ, there would be, I'm told, a very public call for an independent prosecutor to move forward. There is confidence in the evidence, but for me to phrase it like I did, of course that got picked up everywhere, but the process is different than that.
Gotcha. In terms of Anthony Weiner's laptop, the revelation there, because the pushback from the Clinton campaign has been, you know, oh, these are probably things that everybody already saw anyway, that they're just duplicates. What did you find out about that?
Yeah, they are combing through this, and Catherine Herridge has reported this as well, and using a lot of technology. They have found hits, new hits in the emails that they believe are new emails, in other words, not duplicates, that were on Hillary Clinton's server. Also on the hacking of the server. That is interesting because there is a high, high confidence that foreign intelligence agencies, several of them, up to five actually, have managed to hack into that private server. That is not a new feeling inside the FBI or in the intelligence community, actually. If you go back to July, there was a big New York Times piece about the experts believe it was hacked. Comey said at the time that it was possible that foreign actors got into the computer, hostile actors. He also then said, so shortly after that, hostile actors did gain access to private commercial email accounts of people whom Secretary Clinton was in regular contact. And then he went on to congressional testimony to say that the server had less security than the average Gmail account.
That's right.
So these sources are saying he probably at the beginning should have said a probability that it happened, mm-hmm. or even almost certainty that it happened at some level.
Do the investigators believe that they have evidence of pay for play? That's the main question here.
Yeah, I think they believe that they have a lot of evidence. But as in any case, you have to build the evidence and it continues to come in. You eventually have to get some people to sign on or cooperate and testify. So this is all building evidence to a case that has to be made by a prosecutor. And that's why the jumping to likely indictment, they are going to continue to push for an indictment. And that's what I should have said. But there is a confidence of the evidence that's coming in on this case. Bottom line is, if anybody says the Clinton Foundation investigation is over, it's not. It's wide. It's widespread. Four different FBI offices have taken part in it. It is aggressively being pursued. There is a battle, however, inside the FBI and between the FBI and the DOJ.
What a story. Brett, thank you very much.
Sure.
So how is Hillary Clinton's team handling this development? Senior political correspondent Mike Emanuel is live in Phoenix, Arizona today. Her running mate Tim Kaine holds a rally there in Arizona. What's the response so far on this new report, Mike?
Bill, nothing so far. And my producer Jake Gibson and I have both reached out to numerous Clinton campaign contacts. Craig Manassian from the Clinton Foundation told me, quote, "We're not aware of any investigation into the foundation by the Department of Justice, Federal Bureau of Investigation, or any United States Attorney's Office, and we have not received a subpoena from any of those agencies. It seems at this stage the Clinton campaign is ducking the question, at least for now, and happy to have the Clinton Foundation answer it on their behalf. As for the campaign, Hillary Clinton is heading for typically reliably blue Michigan tomorrow. Her husband, the former president, was in Detroit last night for a meeting with community leaders and local pastors. It was not on his official schedule. Former President Clinton told our affiliate WJBK Fox 2, the election is coming. We want a good turnout. So perhaps some concern there in typically blue Michigan. Hillary Clinton was here in Arizona for a rally last night at Arizona State University. She talked about turning typically Republican red Arizona blue. Clinton is leaving Arizona this hour for battleground North Carolina. More campaigning in North Carolina a day after President Obama was there on her behalf just yesterday.
Wow. Bill? Mike, thanks. More when we get at Phoenix, Arizona there. Mike Emanuel, thank you. Mike, I want to take you right now to a poll that came in late yesterday that from Colorado. That I've been a whole lot of polling out of Colorado. But if you look at it now, this is 39 Clinton, 39 Trump. Johnson and Stein, 5-4 each. That adds to 87%. Okay, so there's another 13% perhaps still out there. And the margin error is plus or minus 4.2 points. So, you know, maybe something's doing out there in Colorado. This was the picture from 2004. George Bush beat John Kerry in that state by about 5 points. And it was a major flip on behalf of the Democrats. Remember they had their convention in Colorado in 2008? And Barack Obama beat John McCain by 9 points and then held on to it against Mitt Romney 4 years later by about 5 points. And the Trump team was in our studio last week saying, hey, keep your eye on Colorado. And we weren't quite sure what to think of it, Martha. Remember that conversation we had with Jason Miller? So maybe there's something doing out there. But if you look at all the what-if scenarios, if Colorado's in play, it sort of changes the map and the path for Trump, perhaps.
You say Colorado is one of the swingiest states, and it is proving to be exactly that. We'll keep an eye on it. So quick reminder here, Fox News is, of course, your election headquarters, but you knew that, right? From now until Election Day, keep it right here for all the latest on the election-related news that goes all the way through November 8th and maybe beyond, perhaps, right? Who knows? We will see, Bill.
See you in Tallahassee. Fox News alert right now. Two American service members have paid the ultimate price after a daring raid overseas. What we are learning about that raid this morning.
And Donald Trump's wife, Melania, hitting the campaign trail. She has been somewhat quiet since the speech that she made at the convention. This is her first solo appearance on the campaign trail. So where is she going, and what does that tell us? And a little bit about what we think she might say.
And Trump saying that he has the momentum as of today. In fact, he's given himself pep talks to stay focused in the home stretch when he said this in Florida.
We've got to be nice and...
Donald Trump's wife, Melania, will hit the campaign trail today. She will give her first ever solo political speech, and her mission is a big one. She is targeting suburban women voters, the college-educated area, right along the main line outside of Philadelphia. So this is an important moment for Melania Trump. Joining me now to talk about the women's vote and the election overall, Tennessee Congresswoman Marsha Blackburn, a Trump campaign supporter. Good to have you with us. Good morning to you.
Good to be with you. Thank you.
So a big moment for Melania Trump. Let's start there. She will talk about, as far as we know, her own immigration experience coming here from Slovenia and what it meant to her to become an American. And what else do you expect?
I think you'll get some insight into her life as a wife and a mother. And she has certainly given herself to being a really good mother and stepmother. And we hear her talk about Barron and how tender she is with that relationship and how involved she is with the other Trump children, supporting her husband and being involved in their lives and supporting them. And I think she's going to enjoy telling a little bit of her story, Martha, and I think people are ready to hear it.
Yeah, and I think she will also talk about what kind of first lady she would be, the
right
kinds of things that she would take on. I mean, let's look at some of the numbers here, because we know that Donald Trump has had a tough time in the polls with women voters, especially college-educated women voters, and there are lots of them in Berwyn, Pennsylvania, and in that area outside of Philadelphia where he really needs to make some headway. Right now, she has 50% of women among presidential likely voters, and he has 36. And just to remind everybody, Mitt Romney, who lost the election, was at 52% with this group. He's got a lot of ground to make up.
There is ground to make up. There's room for improvement, and the Trump campaign knows that. What we do know also, Martha, is that national security, economic security, and health care are the top three issues with women. And I think the reason Hillary has not seen her support in women grow is strictly because of those three issues.
But Congresswoman, we also know that the stories that have dogged Donald Trump during this campaign, from Access Hollywood on, have had an impact with these educated women voters, some of whom sort of, you know, walked up to the line with Donald Trump and then went back
right
across to Hillary Clinton. So, I mean, Melania Trump has her work cut out for him, because I think when a lot of those women look at her, they want to know, why did you stick by him through all of this? Why is that okay?
And women asked that same question of Hillary Clinton.
That's
regarding
true.
Bill Clinton. And for Melania, this is going to be an opportunity for her to say, look, I don't defend what my husband said, but look at what Hillary Clinton does and has done and how she would conduct herself as president. And when it comes to the issues of national security, to the issues of wage stagnation and the economy, you know you're going to get action from Donald Trump. You also know you're not going to get an acceptance of the status quo.
But,
and that troubles women. They want to see change in Washington.
I hear you, but you know, this is what I've heard from the campaign really across the board since the beginning, and I've been asking them this question for a long time. Why isn't there more specific outreach to women? And they always say the same thing, that women care about what everyone else cares about, which I believe is true, but it's not demonstrated in the numbers. So clearly, you know, if you're trying the same tactic over and over and it's not working, you got to try something different. So rolling this appearance out by Melania Trump may be that, but there's 5 days to go. Why didn't this happen a long time ago?
I don't know the answer to why it didn't happen earlier. I do know that Ivanka Trump and some of the female surrogates have done a good job being out there. But Martha, there is always going to be room for improvement. And many women have supported Hillary or wanted to support Hillary because they felt like it would be historic to have a female president. But I'm beginning to hear from women who are independent voters, who are in the workplace, who are so dissatisfied with the way she has run her campaign. They are very concerned about the Clinton Foundation. Many of them know I've had that investigation at the congressional level going of that foundation for over a year, for months now, and they are asking questions about that they don't like the way that sounds. And the honesty factor is also something that concerns them about Hillary Clinton.
Let's play this soundbite from President Obama, because he's trying to tap into something with the male vote, and he's basically saying that there's some sexism going on out there. Watch this.
There's a reason why we haven't had a woman president before. And I think that sometimes, you know, we're kind of trying to get over the hump. I want every man out there who's voting to kind of look inside yourself and ask yourself, well, if you're having problems with this stuff, how much of it is, you know, that we're just not used to it?
What do you think about that?
I really thought the entire thing was a little bit inappropriate. And I have always looked at people and said, vote for me because I'm the most well-qualified person for the job. Mm-hmm. And that is what you want. You're going to break glass ceilings when you have people that are prepared and competent who are going to step up and take the reins in a position. Women want those opportunities. Give them an opportunity and they will perform. But do not promote somebody and do not vote for somebody strictly on gender. You want people to excel when they get that opportunity. That is how you break glass ceilings. So to make this something that is just based on gender, there are so many serious issues facing our country right now.
Yeah, I mean, we see this toward the end of campaigns. You know, the race card gets played in some cases, that if you're not willing to vote for this person or that person, it's because you're racist, perhaps. And now what we're seeing is, if you're not willing to vote for Hillary Clinton, you must have something against women. So quite interesting. Right. Marsha Blackburn, thank you very much. Good to have you with us today.
The network has wrapped up its investigation after DNC chair and former CNN political analyst down in Brazil leaked town hall questions to the Clinton team. Jeff Zucker telling his staff that the behavior is, quote, completely unacceptable, but he also defended the practice of paying campaign surrogates. So then the question today, is this matter settled? Howard Kurtz, Fox News media analyst and host of Media Buzz, and Howie, good morning to you. I imagine, based on the piece you just wrote, the matter is not settled.
Explain. Not by a long shot. And the quotes that you just read were indeed CNN President Jeff Zucker talking to his staff. It's all based on leaks. Zucker, who is a media savvy guy, has been since he ran NBC, hasn't addressed this publicly. And we're being asked to accept the notion that, oh, CNN's, and I confirmed this with a CNN source today. Yes, there's been an internal investigation. Nobody at CNN was found to do anything wrong. Apparently nobody's been punished. But the results of how that investigation was done, somebody had to give these questions to Donna Brazile, those have not been made public, and that does not inspire confidence.
So the column you write, why won't CNN disclose its internal investigation? You want to know what they did, right?
Well, I think their viewers have a right to know what they did. CNN, look, I have no doubt that Zucker and all the journalists at CNN are appalled by what happened. But imagine if this was Hillary Clinton and new questions had come up about the Clinton Foundation, say. And Hillary Clinton would not address those questions publicly. But her staff would leak that, well, we've looked into it internally and we've concluded that nobody at the Hillary Clinton campaign did anything wrong. Trust us. How do you think CNN would cover that? How do you think all of us would cover that? So I don't think, if you're going to do an internal investigation, the whole reason is to show that you've aggressively looked into it, that you held people accountable, that it's not going to happen again. If you don't make the findings public, you don't get any of that.
Well, so now there's a conversation about whether or not outlets should even hire surrogates for the campaign. Zucker said this, by the way, quote, one bad apple does not ruin it for the entire process. They add to our coverage in a very meaningful way. John Klein ran CNN too a few years back, and he was on with Megan the other night, and he was making the case that, you know, networks should not hire surrogates. I don't know what your position is on that, but go ahead and answer that, then I'll make my point.
Well, it is a really good point, and if I were the king of all media, I think I would say let's not hire and pay campaign surrogates, because, you know, some of them are very good, some of them are very smart, some of them have shown independent judgment, but a lot of them, come on, we know they're consulting with the campaigns, they're doing spin, they're repeating talking points. I'm not sure how much that adds. That's not to suggest that any of them have done what Donna Brazile did, though she continues to deny it, in leaking internal information. Indeed, most of them don't have access to internal information, but it does. We should examine what value we're getting by paying
I would argue, because I do think that they have a contribution to be made here. And whether they're spinning you or not, they have access to people on the inside. I think it comes back to the process. And you, as a network, how do you quarantine the process? How do you restrict the amount of information that goes out among the handful of individuals who are responsible for debate prep? And your ability to control that information, I believe, is what is critical. I'll give you the last word on that, Howard.
Yeah, I mean, I know that at Fox and I know that at CNN, you know, these things are very closely held. You can't have debate questions or town hall questions shared with the whole newsroom because newsrooms are leaky places. But occasionally you're going to have a mishap like this, and it does cause some self-examination about whether or not the people that you put on the payroll who are clearly part of politics. Remember, Dunham was vice chair of the DNC at the same time she was a CNN contributor, whether they have dual loyalty and whether, in fact, their loyalty is more to their political brethren than to your network.
You need to keep it tight. Howard Kurtz, thank you. We'll check out your column at foxnews.com. Thank you, Howard.
Thanks, Bill.
Martha.